Welcome, BC Calc. These are snow days lectures. Obviously, we've lost some more days. This is being recorded on Wednesday, the 25th, but in all likelihood, we'll lose Thursday and Friday as well. So we do need to stay up to speed. This was our revised timeline. Note that we lost all of these days. We were here Monday and Tuesday. This was the integration by parts material. I think you're okay with integration by parts. I really want to get a head start on trig, integrals, and trig substitution. So these lectures are going to cover 5, 9.5, and 9.6. But I didn't bring my book home, Mr. Bosque. Well, not to fear. I can take care of you. Here's your class page. And if you go to topics, you should find somewhere in here, snow days, lectures for study at home. So yes, I've scanned in the pages that you need out of chapter 9. So this is just a big PDF file, and you can go through this. Here's the 9.1 integration by parts, right? 9.2 is integration by parts. 9.3 is rapid repeated. So we've done that. We did some of these problems in class. Why is this important? Well, because it does have the exercises. Okay, so when you're sitting back there going, but Mom, I didn't bring my book home, Mom now knows that you do have these integration by parts problems. So yeah, you should be able to work these without having your textbook at home. The other thing that's on your class page is, pull that back up again, the solutions. So yes, I copied the pages, but I also copied the solutions. So here's, for example, you know, the solution, the first problem in 9.3. So when you were dealing with section 9, and you needed to work problem, you know, 1 out of the problem set, 9.3, wherever it went to, you do have the solutions available. So you should be able to check your work. This problem has that solution there. Okay, so enough of the nuts and bolts. Let's look at the material. What I want to do is I want to cover, we're skipping 9.4, so you don't have to worry about that. But 9.5 is titled Integrals of Trig Problems. Let's see, grab the exact title here. Integrating Special Powers of Trigonometric Functions, 9.5. And let me just throw a easy one at you. If I have the sine of fifth to the x, cosine of x dx, and I say, I want you to come up with that antiderivative. And you go, wow, I don't know that I can do that. Well, if you think about it just for a second, this is the sine of x raised to the fifth times the cosine of x dx. And so you might gravitate towards the power rule. You know that the integral of u to the n du is simply u to the n plus 1 over n plus 1, plus your constant. And sure enough, this is our ugly. I think it sort of screams that the exponent is 5. But what do you make of this cosine of x dx? That happens to be the ugly, right? So pretty clear, if u is the sine of x, then du is going to be the cosine of x dx. So this problem, even though at first glance it looks a little intimidating, is actually pretty trivial. Since it is a power rule function, we can integrate this very quickly. Sine to the fifth x cosine of x dx is simply going to be the sine to the sixth of x over 6. raise the power up by 1, divide by the new power. That is not in this section. This section has this problem in it. Sine of fifth to the x cosine cubed x dx. And you go, well, it's sort of like the idea, but now I've got too many cosines sitting here. I really only want 1 cosine of x dx. I don't want cosine x cosine x cosine x dx. So how do we deal with this? Okay, so the technique is actually pretty simple. And frankly, I don't know that you'll see this in May, but I am going to test you on it when we come back. So you do have to know this. We know that cosine squared plus sine squared is 1. That's our basic trigonometric identity. You can't get out of trig without having that beaten into your brains. So that the cosine squared of x is 1 minus the sine squared of x. Same identity, just move the term over. So what are we going to do with this problem? You're going to write this as the sine to the fifth x times the cosine of x times the cosine squared of x. And then you're going to replace this cosine squared with this. So let's see. Now we have the sine to the fifth x cosine of x. And now we have 1 minus the sine squared of x. And we still have the dx. Okay? Now, why did we want to do that? Well, I'm going to rewrite this a little bit different. I sort of hesitate doing this, but I think it makes the learning process a little bit easier. Now, it's sort of silly to see the differential in the middle part of the integral here, but why do I do that? This we know how to integrate, right? We did that up at the top. That was an easy problem. Okay, so this one's easy. Happy face. What I want to do is I want to take that, multiply it times 1, but I also want to multiply it times this. So we're going to distribute this whole box across, and this is what we have. We have the integral of the sine to the fifth x cosine of x dx, which we know how to do. Okay, and then minus the integral of, now, when you multiply this through, we're going to have sine to the seventh x cosine of x dx. Right, because we have sine to the fifth multiplying by sine squared, so that's sine to the seventh. And both of these are easy to do. We already know this one. This is sine to the sixth over six. And now we have this one as well. This is sine add 1 to the power to the eighth over 8 plus a constant. Okay, so we're done. Whenever you have an odd power of sines and cosines, you're going to use this basic identity. Odd powers of sines and cosines. You're going to use this to get rid of the even powers and keep the odd powers. Okie dokie. Let's look at the first example in the book. Okay, so the first example in the book has the integral of sine to the seventh x dx. And obviously that's an odd power. So we know that this is the integral of sine to the sixth times the sine dx. Okay, and this is what we're going to use our trig identity on now. So let's see. This is the same as the sine squared cubed, right? Sine of x dx. And you can just follow along in your text if you like. And we know what sine squared is. That's 1 minus cosine squared. Here's our basic Pythagorean identity. 1 minus cosine squared of x cubed sine of x dx. And hopefully you remember Pascal's triangle, 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 1, 3, 3, 1. And you do know how to expand this. I mean, I suppose that if you're algebra challenged, that may be a little bit of a hassle, but let's see if we can do this without too much grief. We're going to have 1 minus 3 from the triangle, 1 squared, which is still 1, cosine squared, and then plus 3 from the triangle, 1, to the first power times cosine to the fourth power, and then minus cosine to the sixth power. That's doing the expanding. We still have the sine of x dx here. Okay, so no problem there. Now let's go and do a little bit more distributing here. We still have this dx, so we're going to distribute, right? So we get four different intervals. The first one is the sine of x dx, and you could go, wow, I wish they were all that easy. Okay, the second one, we have a 3 cosine squared x sine of x dx, and if you just look at that for a second, that's not too bad. And then we have 3, and I suppose for this one, let me go ahead and move that 3 out as well. It's just a constant, we can move it out. So 3 times the cosine to the fourth x sine of x dx, and that's not too bad. And then lastly, you have minus the integral of the cosine to the sixth x sine of x dx. And each one of these, fairly easy to do. Let's go ahead and finish this out. So, and you could obviously refer to your book. The integral of the sine is negative cosine. So that takes care of that one. Done. This one, minus 3. Let's see. In order to integrate, we're using the power rule here. The integral of u to the n du is u to the n plus 1 over n plus 1. My u is the cosine of x, so my du is supposed to be minus the sine of x dx, and I need a negative 1 right in here, negative 1, right? And so make this a negative, and that should compensate. So then we're good. We have plus 3, raise the power up by 1, divide by the new power. Okay, same thing happens here. We do need a factor of negative 1 in there. So put a negative 1 here. So now we get negative 3 and cosine, raise the power up by 1, divide by the new power. Takes care of that guy. And the last one, sort of the same deal. We're going to need a factor of negative 1 in there. Make this a positive. So we have plus cosine to the seventh of x over 7, and then plus your constant. Okay, interesting problem, using odd powers of sines and cosines. Okay, second example. Let's see. We've got even powers. Okay, so now, if we have odd powers, you're going to use that. Let me just pull up a new page here. Odd powers of sine and cosine, you always use the fact that cosine squared plus sine squared is equal to 1, and you can usually reduce it down without a lot. What happens if you have an even power? So suppose we had something like this, the sine squared of x dx. Well, you say, well, I know what sine squared is. That's just going to be 1 minus cosine squared. But if you look at that, you'll notice that this is not really any easier than the first one. I can integrate the 1 and get x, but then I have this, cosine squared of x dx, and that doesn't do me a lot of good. So, maybe I can use my Pythagorean theorem there, right? 1 minus sine squared of x dx. All of this is legit. I'm not sure it's going to take us anywhere. Okay, so we have x minus, let's see, the integral of 1 is x, that goes away, and then we have minus minus, which is plus the integral of sine squared x dx, and we get the profound fact that this integral of the sine squared is the same as the integral of sine squared, because these go away. Well, that didn't get us anywhere, we're just spinning our wheels. Even powers of sines and cosines do not help us. This particular identity does not help us. So it works fine for odd powers, but not for even powers. Okay, so for even powers, there's a different approach. Even powers of sine and cosine. You're going to have to use an identity from trig. Now, I would wager that nobody remembers this, but because it's used in calculus, you will be using this so frequently that you will remember it after just a day or two. The cosine squared of x, or the cosine squared of an angle, can be written as 1 plus the cosine of 2x divided by 2. The sine squared of an angle, interestingly enough, is 1 minus the cosine of 2x, still over 2. So even though this has a sine here in the identity, it's still the cosine. And of course, the only difference between these two is this one is a positive and this one is a subtraction. Okay, so memorize those two. I suppose we could prove them if we wanted to. We probably did it in trig class at one time or another. One of the identities that was verified in trig. But we don't need to do that. We just need to use them. So let's see how this plays out. Let's suppose we did have this idea of the integral of the sine squared. How does this particular identity help us? Well, the integral of sine squared can now be written as the integral of 1 minus the cosine of 2x over 2 dx. And I'm going to break that up to make it a little bit easier to deal. I have 1 half dx, that's the first bit, minus the integral of cosine of 2x over 2 dx. And for heaven's sakes, don't go canceling the 2s. Can't do that. So we have to work each of these separately. Well, the first one is trite, right? The integral of 1 half x is 1 half, or 1 half dx is 1 half x. That's done. And now for this one, let me take out the 1 half and just deal with the integral of the cosine of 2x dx. And again, the trig integral or trig integration formula comes to mind. The integral of cosine of u du is the sine of u. So we're supposed to know that. In this case, the u is 2x, so the du is 2 dx. I don't have 2 dx, I need a 2 in here. So I'll insert a 2, but then I have to balance it with a 1 half. Okay, so playing with this problem a little bit further, I have my 1 half x minus 1 fourth, the integral of cosine of 2x times 2 dx. And so for my final answer, I have 1 half x minus 1 fourth. The integral of cosine is sine of 2x plus a constant. Okay, so that would be that one, the integral of sine squared. Example 2 is very similar to this. The integral of sine squared of 8x. Sine squared of 8x dx. And here was my identity again, sine squared. And let me do u here instead of x. Sine squared of u is 1 minus the cosine of 2u over 2. Sometimes these are called double angle identities or power reducing identities. You can sort of see what happens. The second power gets reduced to a first power, so that's nice. But the angle gets doubled, so the angle here is u, the angle here is 2u. So you just have to think whenever you're using this power reducing identity, the angle gets doubled. So the sine squared of 8x, we're going to reduce the power, 1 minus the cosine to the first, but the angle gets doubled. So 16x over 2. Okay, so that's this particular integrand. So let's see how it plays out. The integral of the sine squared 8x dx is now going to be the integral of 1 half dx, and then minus the integral of the cosine, we still have the 1 half there, cosine of 16x dx. Okay, and like the other guy, u for this problem is 16x, du is 16 dx. We need a 16 in here, so we're going to put a 1/16 out front, and then we should be able to finish this in your book. 1 half x minus 1 over 32 sine of 16x plus a constant. Okay, so you should go ahead and start to work some of the exercises. Now, frankly, if you know the the simple ones with sines and cosines, I'm not going to worry about powers of secants and cosecants. So there are other identities, but certainly know the ones for sines and cosines, and I'll be content. I won't test you anything other than that. So these two are sort of the new ones, and the other identity that you obviously know in your sleep was this one. Okay, so the basic Pythagorean identity uses for odd powers of sines and cosines, and the two new ones for even powers of sines and cosines. Okay, so that's section 5, trig integrals. Work some problems out of the problem set. Focus on sines and cosines. Don't worry about secants and cosecants or tangents and cotangents. There are identities for those as well. Okay, 9-6. Let me see how long we've been running here. 20 minutes. Okay, let me go ahead and stop this one at 20 minutes and let you practice 9-5, and then I'll post another video for 9-6, which are trigonometric substitutions, because that's something else I want you to know. Very unlikely you'll see it in May, but it is highly likely that you'll see it on your chapter test. Hint, hint.